Good morning, or perhaps good evening, depending on where you're joining us from. Thank you so much for taking the time to join us today. My name is Coral Owen. I'm the Professional Development Coordinator for the Military Families Learning Network. It's my pleasure to kick things off for today's session. In case you're joining us for the first time, I'd like to give you a brief tour of our webinar platform so you can find your way around. Hopefully you're currently able to view the slides that we're sharing. If you're unable to see them or having any other technical difficulties, currently or throughout today's session, you can reach out to us via email for tech support. I'll pop our MFLN email address in the chat in just one moment. As many of you have already done, we look forward to having you join us in the chat pod today for conversation and questions, as well as hellos. To embed the chat so you don't miss any links or conversations, simply place your cursor over the shared slides. You should then see a toolbar pop up across the bottom of your screen, and then from there, simply select that chat bubble icon. When typing your comments and questions today, I'd invite you to select that all panelists and attendees response option from the drop-down menu. It's located right above where it says type message here. This just ensures everyone's able to view those comments as they come through the chat and facilitates a more robust understanding of our conversation today. We'll also be covering evaluation and continuing education, the information at the end of today's session. The Military Families Learning Network is part of a DoD USDA partnership for military families, and our passion is to connect military family service providers and cooperative extension professionals to research and to each other through innovative online programming. It's now my pleasure to turn things over to my colleague, Rachel Browner, with the MFLN Military Caregiving Team to introduce today's speaker. Rachel?
Thanks, Coral, and thanks for kicking us off and getting started. Today, it looks like we have a good crowd on from all over East Coast and West Coast. So we're excited for today's presentation. And as Coral mentioned, my name's Rachel Browner. I'm with the Military Caregiving Team. And so if you have any questions, please feel free to utilize that chat pod throughout the session. Just want to reiterate that that is a great way to get those questions back to our presenter today. But then also it makes this platform a little bit more personal if we can have that conversation through that chat pod if needed. I appreciate those that have typed in the chat pod where you're from. Please continue to do so as you log on. Again, it makes this a little bit more personable. We get to see where everyone is joining us from across the US and sometimes outside of the US as well. So thank you again for joining us. This month's military caregiving webinar is a little different than usual. In honor of National Family Caregiver Month, our team decided to do a little something different, and we really wanted to reach out and have an actual caregiver on and provide their perspective as it relates to their caregiving journey as they cared for their loved one. And what better person to be able to provide that perspective to our military providers and family caregivers that are on today than Ms. Lee Woodruff. Lee is a special guest this month with our team. She's going to discuss her family story when her ABC News journalist husband, Bob Woodruff, was hit by a roadside bomb while reporting on the war in Iraq. And Ms. Woodruff will be sharing her perspective on what got her through, what advice she has for others, and offer ways caregivers can relieve stress and reach for joy. As co-author of the best-selling In an Instant, Lee Woodruff garnered critical acclaim for the compelling and humorous chronicle of her family's journey to recovery following her husband Bob's roadside bomb injury in Iraq. Appearing together on national television and radio since the February 27th publication of their book, the couple has helped put a face on the serious issue of traumatic brain injury among returning Iraq war veterans, as well as the millions of Americans who live with this often invisible but life-changing affliction. They have founded the Bob Woodruff Foundation to assist wounded service members and their families. And to date, the foundation has raised more than $70 million to help veterans successfully reintegrate into their communities and receive critical long-term care. Woodruff has been a contributing reporter for CBS This Morning and Good Morning America. Her best-selling book, Perfectly Imperfect, A Life in Progress, was followed by her first novel, Those We Love Most. And so before Lee hops on and provides her story and her journey and advice for others, we'd like to start off with introducing just this video of her story to kind of set the stage for today.
After years of dedicated reporting, Bob Woodruff had finally fulfilled a longtime dream. In December of 2005, he was officially named the co-anchor of ABC's World News Tonight. He seemed to have it all, a loving marriage and four beautiful children. On the morning of January 29, 2006, Bob was reporting from an Iraqi tank that was on patrol north of Baghdad. In an instant, just 26 days after starting his new job, Bob's life would take an explosive turn.
The phone rang, and the voice said, "Lee, this is David Weston, who's the president of ABC News," and my heart sort of stopped. You know, I knew that this wasn't good.
Bill, we have some breaking news to report. Our co-anchor of World News Tonight, Bob Woodruff, and his cameraman, Doug Vogt, were injured in an attack.
We are following developments on the condition of ABC News anchor Bob Woodruff.
ABC News anchor Bob Woodruff.
Bob and Doug were quickly evacuated to a U.S. military hospital.
Both have head injuries. They are in the hospital.
About all we really know is that both are in serious condition.
When Bob first arrived here, he was in a semi-comatose state. He was not following commands. He had one particular rock that was about half dollar in size that completely traversed from the left side of his neck to the right side of his neck, and that was sitting right on top of the carotid artery. Certainly the surgery he had had done in Iraq saved his life. The real question was, what kind of individual we'll have at the end of this period?
I wanted to know, you know, how he would feel about me, if he would recognize me. And so I looked at Dr. Armanda and I said, you know, will he still love me? And he said, yes. He said that he hasn't had a patient yet who didn't wake up and love the people that he loved before. And he was right. He was always right. So I walked in the room and I parted the curtain and Bob was sitting up in bed and he turned to me and he said, "Sweetie, where have you been?" Just like that.
Where did I get you?
And I think I rushed over to him and, you know, gave him a big kiss, and then I thought, okay, where do I begin?
You want to see that there's a knife right here? There's like one.
Eyeball.
Mm-hmm. You taught me, I.
Watching the brain put itself together has been an incredible miracle.
Belt buckle.
What?
Belt buckle.
Belt burl.
Belt buckle.
Belt buckle.
Belt.
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 No, Nora, you're confusing him. Belt.
Belt.
Buckle.
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 Belt.
Buckle.
Buckle. Belt buckle. You taught me, belt buckle.
Diamond.
You did
diamond,
it.
Diamond.
I can't really talk, but I can sternly dance and dance.
Even at the lowest moments, in my core of my heart, I always believed he would be okay. Even when the doctors were telling me something different, I would look at them and I would say, "But you don't know my husband. You don't know my Bob. He's a fighter and he's smart and he wants to live." And I think they thought I was all crazy. But now I can say I was right.
I mean, when I think about what my wife got through in all this, how she made it through this, I did this to her, you know, I did this to the family in a very sad way. But she's wonderful.
So you go to Germany, which is that he's transferred to Germany, and what's that like to see him? Are you just losing it, or are you trying to keep it together, thinking maybe he's feeling some of this?
I'm keeping it together, and I'm actually at the time thinking,
Darn, his brows look really good.
I was looking on the positive aspect of all this.
I think I had to focus in on this tiniest little thing to stay sane because the rest of it was horrific.
Bob and I have always shared a great sense of humor. And I've said so many times that if we couldn't laugh, we would probably be crying.
You're talking to him, you're...
All the time, I'm rubbing his disgusting feet, I'm cutting his nails, I'm doing things that as a wife I need a little payback on right now. Right. Yeah.
Well, I always know there's a lesson in everything. And I hear that you, Bob, have a renewed sense of gratitude.
Out of this thing, something positive has happened. The chance to meet some of the others that have gone through this, the ones in the soldiers and the Marines as well.
If we can somehow, out of this, help those that are getting injured a little bit more than they're being helped right now, then that would be worth it.
Is he your Bob?
He is my Bob. He's so my Bob. I'm amazed.
Fare thee well. My own true love.
There's this moment at night when he crawls in next to me and he's right there and I just sort of touch his back or his chest or whatever and I just think, I can't believe you're here. You should not be here by any textbook known to man, any medical textbook, and you're here. It's just, it's a gift. Every night is a gift.
But I'll be back. Though I go 10,000 miles, 10,000 miles, my own true love. Miles or more, the rocks may melt and the seas may burn.
Hi, everyone. Okay, this is the 15 year later version of me. Okay, so for all the caregivers out there who know just how beat up you get from being a caregiver, okay, this is 15 years later. So nice to be here. So honored to be here. Rachel and team, thank you for inviting me. It always feels like a privilege to speak to our military families, and I can't say enough about how honored I am with your service and all that you've done. So just a little misty coming out of that video because I haven't seen it in so long. Thank you, COVID, for not allowing us to get together and do things. So this is lovely. I think the format, and Rachel, please throw in, is that you guys just ask questions throughout this. I'm going to start telling my story. I think that the nice thing about the video is it was so long ago, probably most of you don't know who Bob Woodruff is and don't remember our story because life moves on as it should. And so that kind of sets up the general part of us. But I want to come at this today from the caregiving perspective, because I think that we live in an age, hopefully, where caregivers are finally getting their due, where people recognize that if caregivers don't have the oxygen that they need, the old plane analogy, right? If you put the oxygen on yourself first, and that we are heroes only so much in that we get our own resuscitation and help and all of that in terms of being able to get what we need from things. And that's certainly community in so many ways. I'll talk about these elements a little bit, and I'd love to hear what gets you guys through too, or what are your things. But it was a couple of years later, and I realized that there were four things that were sort of the leg of my stool that held me up. And they all started with F. in many audiences later, and some military audiences too. There have been some other F words that people have come up with that are surrounded by caregiving, but we can't say that here, so we're not going to use that here. But all four of those words really are probably things you can all relate to. So the things that got me through: family, of course. Bob has three brothers. I have two sisters. We were fortunate enough that they could be with us through the entire journey. Friends, where would we be without our friends? The people who brought over food. And for all of you who have the family support groups, and when you're on base and you have the incredible sort of organization of that, that's amazing. But we have this little town that we live in outside of New York City, and everybody helped. Everybody brought something over, gave a ride somewhere. The third F is, for me, is faith. And that means different things to different people. But to me, when you believe in a higher power, whatever that is, we're all probably talking about the same thing, Yahweh, Allah, God, Jesus. It doesn't matter what the religion is, but just those moments when you're down on your knees, and so many of you can relate to that, and you just have to like look up and say, okay, God, I can't do anymore. I'm just going to turn this over. Those were always the moments I felt a reboot, just because somewhere down there, I just felt like there was more than that. And don't let me forget to tell you my story about faith in a VA hospital with an incredible nurse. So you guys prompt me if I forget, because this talk just kind of comes from my heart and wherever I feel like going during the day. And sometimes I forget to circle back. The last F is funny, because I think when you go through tough stuff, a sense of humor is so critical. And we laughed a lot. I'm actually in LA this week, and it just sort of worked out that we were down here. And Bob and I got a chance to reunite with the producer who was in the tank when the IED exploded. And Vinny was not hurt. Thank God he was inside the tank. But we got together two nights ago, and we were just laughing of all the stupid stories that we just would crack up in the hospital. And sometimes people would look at us and like, really, they're laughing? Like, he's in a coma. It doesn't look good for him. But if you can't laugh, you will cry, is my theory. And I read something once, and I love it. I've never forgotten it. It's the whole concept of whistling, you know, across the graveyard, and being able to sort of laugh in the face of danger. And someone explained to me that when you can laugh at the thing that scares you, it gives you control over that thing. And when you have control over something, because you don't have control over so many things as a caregiver, that just makes you feel better, because we all need control. So those were my four Fs that I sort of realized in hindsight got me through. And I would love to hear, you know, from you guys too in the chat room, what are some of the other things. I will say that I speak really openly about mental health and caregivers' mental health, because there's still so much of a stigma in this country about that. And I got everybody to shore, as I call it. Bob woke up from his coma after 36 days. That really looked bad. It looked like he would, you know, they warned me like he'll never probably be able to really speak on the phone, or certainly not going to work again. Like, forget that this is ever going to happen. And I had sort of prepared for the worst. And you guys know, you minimize, you know, you get your expectations down to the point where, you know, please, Lord, just make him wake up. Like, that's my baseline. Forget about work. Forget about all that stuff. That doesn't matter. Just make him wake up and be able to come back at some level as a husband and as a father to our four kids. And then the kids kind of went back to school, and Bob was getting better, and I crashed. And I bet some of you guys can relate to that, of course, right? Because what is up cannot stay up all the time. We are human beings. And I had this superhuman energy during that point in time where I just needed to take care of everybody. And then that was over. That failed me. And I ended up going on an antidepressive for about a year, because I had like horrible 3:30 in the morning wake up, anxiety, I had panic attacks. I had never understood what that was before until I had one. And that was terrifying. And I thought, oh my gosh, here's my husband sleeping next to me. He's got half a skull. You know, he can't get out of bed without a helmet for months. And I've got two kindergartners and two middle schoolers, and oh my gosh, how am I going to take care of everybody? And if you can't work again, you know, I'd always been a freelance writer and journalist. And so, okay, maybe I need to, you know, go somewhere with health insurance and all of the plan B stuff that I bet you guys realize like that was a coping thing too, right? Like, what's my plan B? What's my backup? So I kind of crashed and just felt this sense of despair. And even though I had those four F's working for me and that you know, way of, you know, trying to help me through, I ended up speaking to somebody, a therapist. And I want to share this advice with you because I think it was super helpful. So he said, you know, when you're feeling anxious or you're worried, go outside. So that is the, to me, like just go walking outside and seeing nature somewhere or looking at the sky if you're in a city and just realizing that the world is bigger than we are, that there are wonderful things out there because we can get really closed in when we stay in our spot and with our person or our people and it can feel small. And just go to the land is what he said to me. And so if it's as small as like picking a flower outside or looking at a leaf or standing outside and lifting my head up to the sun and closing my eyes a little bit and feeling that, that was a really, really useful thing. The other thing he said, which I'm going to tell, I usually say this at the end, but I'm going to say it now just in case I forget, is one of the sort of mantras he said, when you wake, I said, what do I do at 3:30 in the morning? What do I do when all those birds are flying? It felt like birds flying around the room, like, you know, flying at me and attacking me. And he said, ask yourself these questions. And if anybody is a student of psychology, this is just sort of Maslow's hierarchy of needs. And I also always need to say that not all of us can answer these questions with a yes, which is part of the reason we're all out here, which is part of the reason Bob and I started the Bob Woodruff Foundation to help. But ask yourself these questions. Do you have a roof over your head? And I know not everybody does, but if you can answer yes and I can, then that's great. Do you have enough to eat? I do, yes. Do you have people that love you? I'm so lucky that I do. Do you have people you love? Absolutely, tons of them out there. And have you always been able to figure out how to get these things? Like, have you always had these things in your life? And I can answer yes, I'm a lucky girl. I get to answer yes. Well then, roll over, go back to sleep, and it's all gonna look better in the morning. And he was right. And every time I've needed that little thing to like stop it, stop that spinning of thoughts, it's worked. So I wanted to share that with you. Andrew's asked a nice question here too about asking you guys, what's the role that professionals have played? And I think that was my point where a professional really helped me. And I hadn't been somebody who had done a lot of therapy. I felt like I'd always been able to figure out my own happiness. But honestly, the first step is realizing that some of this is bigger than you, that it's not that you're failing or that you're not strong enough for. And I know for so many of the people I've met in the military world, and it's been such an honor. There's just this code and you guys are strong. And there's this belief that, no, you know, we should be able to do this, but you know what? We are all human. And the thing about situational depression, which was the name of the thing that I had, was, you know, this isn't some failing in you. This is a really big thing that happened in your life, that came into your life and changed your life that you didn't ask for. And that's okay that you should be having all these feelings and struggling. That's completely the normal reaction. There is nothing wrong with you. And I kind of needed to hear that. I needed that normalized for me. So let me go back a little bit to our story. Bob and I met in college. We sort of didn't really know each other that well there, but we ran into each other later after college. And that ended up just being like, that's the guy. That's my guy. Maybe some of it was the right time in my life too. But I married a lawyer. We moved to China and he spoke Mandarin and Tiananmen Square happened. That's how old we are, guys. Does anybody even know what Tiananmen Square is? You're probably all 18. I'm going to guess. I'm kidding. And that opened his eyes to what he really wanted to do in life. He said, I want to be a journalist. I want to be places where history's happening and I want to report on it. And I want to be, I want to use my camera. I want to tell stories with pictures. So that led to a life not unlike a military family of moving almost every 2 years. We started in a tiny TV market in Redding, California. And kind of every 2 years when a contract was up, we would move. So I could really, really relate to so many of the families that I met in Bethesda Naval Hospital, because this sense of having to pick yourself up and reinvent your family, find your friends, figure out your pediatrician, you know, just, you know, what's the landscape look like, was my life for a very long time. And we lived overseas as well, too, which is just an extra level of difficulty, isn't it, to just sort of put yourself in other cultures. So he pivoted, and our family grew as we moved around. We got to ABC, he got to ABC Network, and he'd always wanted to cover international stories. And he found conflict areas and war zones, fascinating places, in that he would say to you, those are the places where, as a journalist, you see the best of human nature and you see the worst. And in 2003, when we went to war with Iraq, he embedded with the 4th Light Infantry Division of the Marines. And I think the military were sort of like, all right, who are these fat, overweight journalists coming to embed with us? And really, we have to like have their six as well. And it was interesting to see in that time that they spent together, sort of certainly the admiration that journalists have for the military, but maybe a little bit of the mutual admiration back, if only it was to be able to use their phones to call home and see their new babies. But then the journalists were all like, here, take my phone, take my cell phone, talk to your wife as long as you want. But honestly, the respect, I think, for those that were willing to embed and wear the chem suits and ride along and not be a burden. And Bob was one of those guys. And the fact that he had made it all the way through, we in 2003, our best friend David Bloom, who was an NBC reporter and was embedded with the Army, passed away in Iraq from a deep vein thrombosis. And it turned out he had a genetic factor that made him predisposed to this. But a lot of you guys remember sleeping in tanks with your legs up. I mean, it was total economy class syndrome, heat, chem suits. So David stepped out of the tank, and the blood clot had hit his lungs or his heart, and he died. And at that moment, Bob got a chance, because he was a civilian, to do something you guys don't get to do. He got to leave. He got to be there. He wasn't there when David arrived in Dover, and I could see somebody here is here from Dover. Thank you for that. I remember the movie, was it Taking Chance or something with Kevin Bacon? I think I bawled all the way through that. But it was about a soldier coming back to Dover, or ended up in Dover. Anyway, that was a defining moment for our family, because in my early 40s at the time, I didn't know anybody close who had died. I certainly didn't know anybody who had died in a war zone. And Bob came home. He wanted to be there for David's three little girls. He wanted to be there for our kids, to show them that even though bad things happen in the world, that life does go on, and that there are wonderful people around to support you. I would not have imagined 3 years later that the roles would reverse and it would be Bob who would be lying really close to death. Cannot say enough about the surgeons, the medics, anybody on the healthcare side in any way in the military. When Bob was rolling down the road in Taji, he had just come out, popped out of the hatch for a few minutes to try to do a stand-up. It was too loud. There was the engine. They were coming to a tree-lined part of the road, and this had been a really bad road for insurgents he was doing a story as the newly appointed anchor of World News Tonight, and ABC had just taken over for Peter Jennings. And he was trying to show all of the wonderful progress that our military was making, all of the good things they were doing, fixing water treatment plants, building schools. This was a road that was pockmarked with IEDs, and everybody had come together, the joint forces, to kind of clean everything up. And, you know, it was a point in the war where IEDs and homemade bombs had really ratcheted up. So just as the soldier was telling them that they should maybe go down, the bomb exploded 25 feet away from Bob on the left side. So all of the shrapnel, which was mostly rocks, just shattered his skull, went up under his flak and shattered his scapula. The flak saved, you know, so much of his life with his torso, but he was immediately knocked out and fell back in the tank. And I think he hit a peripheral nerve on the back of his head somehow. So he's got a little cut out of his vision on the top left. So if you guys ever find yourself on the tennis court with him, definitely lob the ball high, because you're going to get a point off him if you do that. But one of the amazing things about being a caregiver and getting a front row seat to recovery was to watch Bob compensate for stuff. So I remember in the early days, he would like open the newspaper and be like, "Ooh, I kind of can't see over here." So he would lay it down and he would move it around in his point of vision to get around it. And like, the human spirit is so resilient. That was one of the other big learnings watching this guy. And, you know, people, there is just a will to live that we have. And I'm sure a lot of that was fueled by his love for his kids, his love for me. You know, you saw that the video, the kids are lying around him, teaching him words, because he was really injured in his speech and language part of his brain. So he woke up speaking gibberish. Weirdly, here's the funny thing. Here comes that F for funny. Weirdly, he could say Ahmed Ahmadinejad, but he couldn't tell you who the president of the United States was at the time, George Bush. So language is a really funky thing. And I'm going to give you some of the other like funny things that he said, because for anybody whose loved ones had aphasia, you know, there's a lot of funny words that come out. So one day he looked at me and he said, "You know, when I look at you, I just get like dunkles," which meant goosebumps. Don't ask me how I knew that. I'd been married to him for 18 years, but it was his word. It sounds better than goosebumps. Who wants to be a goose, right? Like, dunkles just sounds so much better. And the other one, he said he needed to cut his nails. So he said to me, and he would always do this little like pantomime charade thing. He said, "I need some of those knob shooters." And I knew exactly what he meant. Because think about it, your fingers are little knobs. And when you cut your nails, they always shoot somewhere like in the corner of the bathroom where you can never get them. So we had so many laughs. And that laughter really was a healing thing. And Bianca, thank you. You have to smile through your hardships, because otherwise your heart would be so dark and black. And we found those moments together, and then separately with the girlfriends that supported us. The kids would laugh. I wanted them to not see this as a sad thing, even though I was brokenhearted. Here was this brilliant man who could anchor the news, who could stand up in a war zone and keep the entire newscast in his head, had a photographic memory. All of that was gone in one instant. So how do you move forward in life and make it count and not make this drag you down? Somebody said to me once, you have two choices when the bad thing happens. You can get bitter or you can get better. And I knew that I didn't want to be a bitter old lady. So I needed to find ways to make it okay. Andrew's asking about resiliency. Did it track with his? That's so interesting. Whew. I think that in my marriage, and maybe many of yours, is a yin and yang, right? So he would come home from a war zone, for example, and he had seen a lot of horrible things. And I would have been taking care of the kids for 4 weeks while he'd been gone. And he would come home and he would need those kids to just sort of rejuve his batteries. And I would collapse. Who out there can relate to that? So you're going. That's your adrenaline, because you have to, because there's no one else. And then because he would come home, I would always get sick. I would always end up in bed with some kind of fever. That was sort of my body's reaction. So I think the resiliency between the two of us as a couple probably followed the same track. And I have to say, for many, many months, his self-awareness about how badly he was injured was coming back online. So even though I could look at it and say, "Oh my gosh, you know, look what he's lost. I don't know where this will end," you know, as he started to improve and things would come back, you never know where this goes with a brain injury. So, you know, no one can tell you where it's going to end up. But I was seeing progress, and that progress was heartening to me, because you know, I think you don't know what you don't know. I kept thinking, no, he's going to be the one that comes back 100%, which of course no one really does with a brain injury. But I love that question, because I've never actually thought about that fully, but I have a feeling that we toggled back and forth. And if I felt like he was maybe in despair, I don't know. There must have been some sort of back brain part of me that was like, nope, you got to put your own feelings down. You got to be there to make this work. I wonder how much of that had to do with young kids and my absolute determination for them to not feel like this had impacted their life. One of Bob's lasting legacies is epilepsy from the brain injury. So he's on Lamictal as an anti-seizure med. And he had a number of really scary seizures. They always seem to happen when I wasn't there. A couple happened when I was. And I just remember thinking, like, I cannot let the children see this. I cannot let them see this. And I'm sure there are many of you out there that can relate to that as well. So he fell back in the tank. This is where some of my undying love for you guys comes from, because it was a planned attack, and behind all those palm trees were a lot of folks with guns. So they just started to open fire as people came out try to help Bob to get out of their vehicles and out of their tanks. They started to open fire. So they had radioed for a medical helicopter to come down and get Bob and his cameraman, who was also injured, a little bit less so, out of there. And then when the gunfight happened, they said, turn around. You got to go back to base. There's no way you can land here. And we got a chance to meet these two guys in the helicopter at Fort Lewis, like, you know, 25 years old, 27 years old, amazing young guys. And I was coming toward them. I've told this story before. I was coming toward them with like mascara, you know, dripping down my face, like, thank you. You guys saved my husband. And they were like, ma'am, this was just our job. We were just doing our job. You know, we don't know who's down there. It's just what we're supposed to do. And that to me is the most amazing thing about all of you, that you sacrifice, for everybody else. So you can see I'm getting a little misty there again. Time for some more coffee. I just realized, I think that's my Nikki Stevens, who's in the chat room. Hi, Nikki Stevens, you beautiful thing, if that's you. These guys told us a story that, hi Nikki, that they heard the command on the radio, and they were like, they looked at each other, they were like, I didn't hear anything. Did you hear something? And the other guy was like, didn't hear a thing. Turned the radio down, the order to go back to the base, and they landed that baby anyway. I think it was about a half a mile from where the gunfight was raging. And they got Bob. And I mean, that's the entire reason I feel like Bob is as good as he is in terms of coming back, because they ignored that order. This was their job. This is your job, guys. I mean, let's just take a minute and think about how amazing that is. And they landed that helicopter. They got Bob in that golden hour to Baghdad first. Here's another amazing thing. At that moment in time at the cache where they'd set up, you know, just this whole like emergency room, there just didn't happen to be a lot of other people in there at that time, and had been really busy earlier. And one of the nurses who we got a chance to meet there later, who was a nurse in Vietnam, Deb Mule, if you're out there, Deb, you're amazing, said to me later, if there had been a triage situation, we would have put your husband at the very back of the line, because we did not expect him to live. And they were able to see him right away. And within that golden hour, they got him back on the helicopter, back to Balad, which is where they were doing the neurosurgical work, in a tent with generators while they were taking mortar fire, and they sawed off 16 centimeters of Bob's skull on the left side. That saved his life. There is no question. His brain was swelling. And if he'd been in a New York City hospital somewhere where everybody had to, you know, sign a million forms and all of that stuff, it just never would have. He would not be the person that he is today. So he stayed in Landstuhl. He went from there to Landstuhl for just like 48 hours. And I went to see him there. And I don't know how many of you guys experienced this when you first got to see your loved one, but I was in such denial when I saw him. His head was horrific. He looked like Frankenstein. The whole thing was swollen like a rugby ball, and there were these stitches, and the left side of his face was destroyed. His eye, I never thought he would see, or his ear was kind of blown off. I couldn't see his back because he was lying on his back, but I just focused on his torso, and he looked like a statue, a marble statue, because it was really cold. He was in this refrigerated room. And I realized, I think later, my mind was just numb. My mind decided not to see the bad stuff And I walked out of that room and said to my brother-in-law, who was about to go in next, yeah, he looks pretty good. My brother-in-law told me later, he's like, Lee, I almost threw up when I saw him. Like, I couldn't believe you told me that he looked good. But I realized then, like, there are protective mechanisms, denial and other things, I think, that we do for each other that just allow us to get through in so many ways. He ended up at Bethesda Naval. And I met incredible families like yourselves, amazing people who, you know, got me through, who got incredible services just like Bob, but who I began to realize that when they would go back home, when they were out of the acute care situation, we're going to go back home to their towns, and that the VA, which was what was their next point of access, sometimes was 3 hours away. And these were caregivers who had children, who had jobs. And I turned to Bob's brothers and I said, you know what, we're getting a ridiculous amount of attention for Bob's injury. This is dumb. If Bob wakes up and if he gets better and I'm able to, you know, I'm not by a bedside all the time or helping him as a full-time caregiver, we need to use this attention that's been paid to him because he's the anchor, and we need to turn it back on these families because this isn't right. And I was one of those dummies who believed that our federal government and my tax dollars took care of everything that you needed when you were injured and returned home from war. And yeah, I would learn so much more about that later and the complexities of it and, you know, just the Megillah of the federal government. But that was when we decided to start the Bob Woodruff Foundation. And I'm really, really proud. We've raised, last night was our fundraiser. I will try to type into the chat before this is over. Our show was live. It was on the ATF and all these places last night. It's free. It's a fun show. You'll see shout outs to amazing veterans like yourselves from a lot of celebrities and, you know, watch it with your families together and just feel the love from this country. Cause I think it's been a hard year to feel love from a lot of different fronts. So, yeah, a lot of roles. Did I struggle with moving back and forth? And guys, this is for you too. Feel free to throw in. And thank you, Alicia, for sharing that. I don't know if I thought a lot about my roles. Andrew, love you. We love our men. But any woman out there knows that we wear 92 hats at any one time, and we can multitask like the devil. So I don't even know if we think about code switching through those roles. Those are the superpower of all the females out there and the caregivers. So I love that question, but I'm going to just say, if I'm just going off my own husband, who's kind of a monofocus guy, we chicks have a lot going on. We get it done. We get it done. But I would love to hear what other people think about that, because you do think about your roles. I don't want to minimize your question and make fun of it, but I think you do. I think the thing that I thought about as I was probably toggling between those roles is, okay, Lee, like, where's the you? Yep, someone just said that. Like, what? Okay, your oxygen level's down. You're like getting snippy at people. Like, what do you need to do to breathe again? And you know what? A good cry never hurt in any way, shape, or form in that front. We finally got Bob home. And that felt to me, the phrase that I used in our book, in an instant, it felt like carrying an egg on a spoon. If you were ever a kid and you played those races, it's exactly what it felt like. And I was afraid to touch him. I said to him the other day after 15 years, Bob, I don't think I've ever touched your head where your scar is. Cause to me, that was just terrifying. And so he made me touch his scar. So that's progress after 15 years. Right. But I knew that his brain was right under the skin for 4 months or however long he lived there. I don't know. I was just so afraid that he would break. And I know that, here's another thing, lovely caregivers out there. I think the thing that we need to do more on, and I know it's a little bit of a burgeoning field a little bit, is our own post-traumatic stress. I can feel it at times. Phone rings at 9:30 at night. I'm on the ceiling like a spider. It's like, what's wrong? Or someone called the other day for Bob. And I thought, okay, where is he? And did he just have a seizure? I didn't say that to the person. That would have given them their own post-traumatic stress probably. But these are the things that I, you know, immediately go to. And no one talks about caregiver. post-traumatic stress. And I think that we will hopefully find ways in the next few years, as we focus more on caregivers and the incredible importance of that to the entire equation, on how we can work on some of those issues as well. I have the privilege of having been appointed to the Family Caregiver and Survivor Committee, subcommittee at the VA. It's a civilian committee appointed by the head of the VA, and Elizabeth Dole runs the foundation. And one of the things that I'm passionate about, I feel like there are a lot of holistic things that we can be offering to our injured service members and caregivers: massage, Reiki, meditation. I don't know if I'm allowed to say this, but even places where they're finding ways that hemp and CBD and, you know, medical cannabis and things like alternative to things like opioids and cigarettes and things that are harmful. And I think that ways in which we can find, alternatives to help all of us and figure out ways to combat post-traumatic stress in not just our service members, but in their caregivers as well. Panic attacks with ambulances. Yeah, I totally get that. I think I do that one too, even though I wasn't there when an ambulance took Bob away. But it flips the switch to your most basic fears. And Alicia, thank you. As my children got older, did my protective role get more stringent? Wow, I haven't thought about that. I'm one of those dummies who had my house broken into when we lived in Phoenix, and they took all my jewelry, and I won't tell you where I live, but I still leave my house unlocked because I feel like if someone really wants to get me, they can. I have tried not to be that protective person with my kids because I feel like at a certain point, there's only so much I can do. But I like this question because I think it spikes up in moments when I least expect it, and I have to work to tamp it down. And I'm a big one on talking to yourself a little bit, because I find that inner voice where I have to say, Lee, you don't have control over this. You don't have control over this. But I can completely relate to that. I think that's some of the hardest work we do as caregivers, is to be able to let go at a certain level. I know I have about 5 minutes or so before I stop and we talk about others. Wait, Jackie's got a question. As a caregiver for elderly parents, compassion fatigue. So my mother's 86. My dad passed away a few years ago from dementia on a 10-year slide. And all this was happening while Bob was recovering. And I, like so many of you, I bet, felt squeezed at both ends. It's that sandwich generation. But I didn't expect to be taking care of my husband so early in my life. I had times where I reached for compassion. And I just want to give everyone out there permission to have it be okay to have those like mean thoughts, or just feel like, oh my gosh, how am I going to do this? Because if those are normal, completely, incredibly human things to feel. And as someone said to me, every day can't be Doris Day. Like, you can't be like sunshine and moonbeams every day. And I always felt like the days where I felt grumpy and crappy, those were the payback days that allowed me to feel the joy of the next beautiful flower that was going to pop out in my garden or the other stuff. So I just always say, give into those days, give into those days. That's exactly what you would, you know, be able to do. Kathy, how do my kids deal with what happened to Bob? Do you know what's interesting? My kids were 12, 14, 5, and 5 when he was injured. And even the 14-year-old, I don't think really remembers what his dad was like. Now, his dad's a fabulous dad. His dad always got what was the most important thing. But there's tweaks after a brain injury, right? He's got a really ridiculous sense of humor, like goofy, like his own father. Okay, be careful who you marry, because they're going to end up like their parents. I mean, it's kind of funny. You might think he's funny, but I've heard all the jokes 90 times. I don't think my kids remember that he wasn't like that. And I have never said to them yet, I've never asked them, okay, how was that for you? And I will someday. And I've never sort of asked them, do you remember dad? I just think that might be one of those things that's too painful for me, because I remember dad. And dad's maybe back 90, 95%. But boy, guys, you can really miss that 5%, can't you? That 5% can be so much, so much. All right, so tips to the professionals who work with caregivers. First of all, can I kiss all of your feet? I'd love to. What would we be doing without you guys? You are where the rubber meets the road. So I want to say to you guys, just forgive yourselves for compassion fatigue. Please take the break to go recharge your battery. My hat is off to you. I don't know how you do this. I don't know how you walk in there every day. I said that to Bob's neurosurgeon once. I said, tell me how you do this every day. How do you deal with all the nurses and the docs and the spouses and the kids? And then you go home and you have to like put your own kids to bed and read them a story. And he talked about how he compartmentalizes. And I'm sure all of you professionals out there know how to do that. That doesn't mean that's healthy for you. That doesn't mean that you can't rage. Here's what I would say. I would say, remember the four F's. I would say, get outside. I would say, exercise. I would say, take breaks, step away from your computer and your phone, and just you do you in the way that you want to do you. I hope that you have an outlet, whether it's another therapist or someone professional to talk to, or a really good friend who's able to sort of listen, because listening is the number one best thing to do, and you probably are doing it all the time. And then I think my last piece of advice is, on days when you don't feel like you're reaching your potential, or maybe even feel like you're failing, and I hope you never feel like you're failing, will you just tell yourselves that you're doing the very best you can do today? And that's all you got, because sometimes that's simply all we got. And that's okay, because we are human too. And every day that I've ever woken up and just felt like, God, this is not the life I asked for. This is not how this was supposed to go. I was just supposed to marry this guy, and we were just supposed to kind of get old together and raise these kids. And we didn't need any of the wonderful things life threw at us, because we found each other. And that was like the big thing. This is my guy. Any day that I feel really sad about that, I remember that sometimes I'll wake up the next day and I'll feel different. It's like that thing I told you at the beginning, where you just ask yourself those couple of questions and then you wake up and it's a new day. And that sounds so Hallmark card, I know, but it's really, really true. Our minds can wake up and be in a different place every single day. And I think that's a super gift, a super gift. So you do describe caregiving as a journey, because that's part of what I just said. Like, some days it just stinks, right? You don't want to do, you didn't ask for this. I thought about being a caregiver maybe in my 70s. And now, based on what a TBI legacy can be, I think like we'll be really lucky if Bob has a good 10 years left with a TBI in terms of dementia and Alzheimer's. I am totally on this journey. I think about myself as a caregiver, but I think sometimes I tend to minimize it, because I feel like caregiver is one of those exalted words that is reserved for somebody whose husband is way, you know, it more incapacitated than Bob. And then I realized, no, you have a right to call yourself that. Because I think sometimes when somebody has had injuries, especially a brain injury, where you could kind of sometimes feel crazy, like, okay, is that what he would have done before? Or is that the brain injury? And then I realized at some point in time, I had to stop thinking that way, stop being in that groove of always going back and replaying the movie. This is your forward life now. And I have to tell myself that a lot sometimes, and that's okay. This is the future now. And it doesn't mean that you can't grieve the past. But I remember Robin Roberts, who the ABC colleague of Bob's, who's gone through a lot of stuff in her life and is the daughter of an airman, said to me, you know, you gotta focus, Lee, on being in the moment, because when you look back, it makes you sad. And I've also later read something else where looking back, that's, and being sad and missing things is depression. And she said, and when you look forward, that's a little scary, because you don't know what's coming. And then I've also learned that's the definition of anxiety, is thinking about the future and knowing you can't control it. And so focusing on being in the present, I'm trying, guys. I'm working on it so hard. Okay, let me talk about grief really quickly before, because again, I want to leave the appropriate amount of time. Grief is a response to loss. So let me talk to you about the word that I learned, complicated grief. Never heard that word before. And it so described my feelings, because we think of grief in this country as an absolute loss. As my friend Melanie Bloom, whose husband David died on the sands of Iraq, and that was absolute loss. She was a widow. She was going to raise three little girls, and she needed to grieve. And boy, did we grieve at the bottom. Like, there was a foundational depth of loss that was so painful. And she went to that place, and she grieved, and she got better. It didn't mean she didn't backslide, but she got better, and she moved forward. And here she is today, however many years later, almost 20 years later. She's remarried, a widower. She misses David every day, but she's in this place. And I thought, I'm in purgatory. Where I am with Bob is, I don't know what I can hope for. I don't know where he'll get to. I don't know where he'll be back. And every single day feels like a paper cut of loss. And I learned that the terminology was complicated grief. You can't really grieve because he's not gone. And no one lets you grieve because they all say, oh, aren't you lucky that your husband's here? So I was just about to cry. And then I'd be like, oh, I guess I have to feel lucky. I have to feel gratitude. I can't find that safe space with this person that I was just about to find. And in some ways, there's no measuring here. There's no first, second, or third. There's no, you know, red, yellow, or blue ribbons for any of this stuff. But I had to come to terms with that this would be a lifelong process, this dance with complicated grief, much like an Alzheimer's patient, or yes, a patient for special needs, absolutely. All of my friends with an autistic child or a Down syndrome child or someone with a disease, a lifelong disease. If you have not Googled this, please, all of you, Google the blog Welcome to Holland. And I can share that with Rachel and the gang, just like I can share the website for the BobWoodrufFoundation.org, BobWoodrufFoundation.org, where you can go see the show for free, the hour-long show with Bruce Springsteen and Jon Stewart and Tiffany Haddish and all these people, and stories about amazing veterans. So do that for fun over the Thanksgiving holiday. But Welcome to Holland. Okay, so somebody says I use it in all my trainings. Yep. Okay, amazing thing. Our daughter, one of our twins, is deaf. And somebody sent that to me when she was diagnosed with special needs and I was facing this incredible journey of trying to give her hearing. Thank you for putting that in there. And I think it might be Stand Up at Bob Woodruff, but you'll see it on the website. But Welcome to Holland is something that everybody, every caregiver, every professional should read, because it's such a lovely way to look at complicated grief. I am a minute over. Rachel has some important announcements and things to make. I just love y'all and thank you for what you do. You are so amazing as your caregivers to those of us professionals, caregivers. You're the best. So I'm going to let Rachel, I'm going to turn it back to you, and say hi to me anytime, guys. I'm LeeMWoodruff@gmail.com, and love you. Thank you.
Thanks so much, Lee. And I appreciate you being on with us today, this morning, and sharing your perspective and your story and your journey as a caregiver, and then also sharing your husband's experience through his TBI. So we appreciate it for our family caregivers that are on, as well as those providers that work with family caregivers. It was a really good insight, and we appreciate it, especially as we recognize November as National Family Caregiver Month. So we really appreciate it. Thank you for being on with us this morning. And for all of the folks that are joining us on YouTube Live, thank you for joining us and staying on as well and connecting with us. Today's presentation, we are still providing CE credit for case managers, board certified patient advocates, and certified family life educators. And then those that are needing just a general certificate of completion, we are still offering that as well. I know this webinar this month was a little different than normal, but we were actually really excited about this new kind of take on monthly webinars. And so Lee, thank you again for your perspective and sharing your story with all of us. As we close out today, if you have any questions, I'm gonna type my email address in the chat pod. So if you have any issues with your CE credits or certificates, please give me a shout out via email. Next month, we're wrapping up our final webinar of 2020. I can't believe we're already close to December. Many of us are probably thinking, let's get 2020 over. But it has been a really good year for our military caregiving concentration area. And so we're going to be closing out this year, focusing on creating meaningful and engaging virtual connections with individuals with disabilities. And so our final presentation and webinar of the year, we'll talk about virtual connections for individuals with disabilities as it applies to personal relationships, virtual learning, and working with service providers. And so that webinar will be on December 17th at 11 a.m. Eastern time. So don't forget to join us next month on December 17th. And then also, we just finished our Military Family Readiness Academy. But we're going to have specific sessions starting in 2021 regarding our concentration areas focus. And so, for example, we're going to have a disaster and hazard readiness and action session for specifically for caregivers and providers, as well as a session on disaster and hazard readiness and preparedness for individuals with special needs. And so mark your calendar, 2021. We are going to be starting off in February of 2021 with our specific sessions for disaster and hazard readiness for the Military Family Readiness Academy. So you can find all of these resources, a copy of today's presentation slides, and I'm going to post that in the chat pod now for everyone in case you're interested in the presentation slides and getting connected to all these upcoming resources. I've posted that event link in the chat pod. So thank you. And please join us. We're going to stay on for a few more minutes as we close out today's session for you to gather any resources, links, any contact information. If you have any questions, I'll be on for a couple more minutes. But we really appreciate you joining us. I hope you have a great rest of the day and a early happy Thanksgiving from all of us from the Military Families Learning Network. Hope you have a safe and wonderful Thanksgiving next week, everyone. Thanks again for joining us. I'm going to go on mute, but we will be on for just a couple more minutes.